France should have had no difficulty in defeating England at the start of this war. It was the richest country in Europe and outnumbered England in population by some 15 million to the British fewer than 4 million. Nonetheless, throughout most of the first three quarters of the Hundred Years' War, the English won most of the pitched battles. One reason for this was that the English had learned superior military tactics, using well-disciplined archers to fend off and scatter the heavily armored mounted French knights. In the three greatest battles of the long conflict, Crecy, Poitiers, and now we will look at Agincourt, the outnumbered English relied on tight discipline and effective use of the longbow to inflict crushing defeats on the French.
King of England. His name was Henry, the fifth king to bear that name. He was already an experienced soldier, having fought successfully to put down rebellions against his father. Although he inherited his throne peacefully, King Henry V knew that the great nobles that surrounded him were only as loyal as it suited them. He needed to divert their attention into a cause that would unite all Englishmen behind their king. Henry V resolved to pursue his claim to the French throne by force. King Henry V was a single-minded man and a ruthless politician. He could have negotiated with the French for the territories that Edward III had been granted by treaty. But sensing this unity in France, he immediately demanded the French crown and marriage to Princess Catherine, daughter of the mad French king, Charles VI. These demands were dismissed by the French princes of the blood, and an insulted King Henry prepared for war. King Henry V had fought against Welsh rebels when his father was king, and had been wounded in the face by an arrow in battle against them. When he began raising his army, knowing the power of the longbow, King Henry made the provision of archers a vital part of his plans.
The development of armor over this period of some 56 years that we're looking at saw the transition from the shirt of mail dominated suit of armor with various steel pieces attached to it, getting very rapidly towards the state of the full plate armor from head to foot. As for the tactics of changes of the period, there had not really been a great deal. The famous groups of archers placed on the flanks of the armored bodies of knights in the English defensive positions, those remained much the same, although there are all sorts of little niceties, what they sometimes call the harrow formation, standing forth in the line of battle, sort of the archers therefore firing at a flank against their attacking enemies and so forth.
With the financial support of the church, parliament, merchants and his people, King Henry soon had sufficient funds to assemble an invasion and furnish an army with weapons. On the afternoon of Sunday, 11th of August, 1415, an armada of some 1,500 vessels began their three-day voyage to cross the Channel. The crossing was uneventful, and the fleet dropped anchor in the Bay of Seine, overlooked by the town of Harfleur. But the landing of the English army was not opposed. The King Henry had issued strict instructions to his men about their conduct on the forthcoming campaign. This was not to be an old-style chevauché with indiscriminate looting, plunder, and rapine. King Henry saw the French as his rightful subjects, and to win their love, he must treat them as such. All his soldiers were told to stitch a cross of St. George to their coats. They were then reminded of the offenses punishable by death: murder, rape, looting, assault on a member of the clergy, desertion, theft from a church. The list went on. With the men ashore, the unloading of the fleet began. Horses, cannons, siege engines, supplies, and men were disgorged onto the mudflats before Harfleur. Meanwhile, King Henry and his generals rode forward and summoned the town to surrender. Harfleur declined the offer. Well provisioned, and with the expectation of swift reinforcements, the townspeople and garrison opted to sweat it out in what they prayed would be a short siege. By the 18th of August, however, King Henry's army had completely surrounded the town, preventing further supplies reaching it. The siege train was manhandled into protected positions around Harfleur and towed onto ramps from where it would launch its projectiles to smash the walls or destroy the turrets and battlements.
Also, there were still being used the methods of digging mine tunnels underneath a wall, putting a lot of wood and pit props and so forth underneath them, and then setting fire to them with the help of oil of sorts put on top of them to make them burn, again causing a collapse of a whole section of wall, whereupon a fortress could be open to assault. That was the ancient way of fighting sieges. But now we have onto the battlefield, or onto the siege area too, the first bombards, those early forms of artillery. Now they could be pretty large, but this was the beginning of the age, therefore, of artillery bombardment of towns.
The laws of chivalry, which dictated the rules of behavior in battle and siege, were meticulously adhered to. Having positioned his siege engines, King Henry again appealed to the French to surrender and spare the effusion of Christian blood. Again, the French politely declined, and so the English bombardment began. And despite what appeared to be overwhelming odds, the French had every reason to be confident. Even with the most modern weapons of war, the process of investing a strongly constructed defense took time. The garrison also knew that the area the besiegers had occupied would create problems of its own. The great guns of King Henry's train had done much to tip the balance of the siege in the English army's favor. The walls of Harfleur were cracked, and in places, clear breaches were being made. On the 22nd of September, the leading citizens of Harfleur knelt before King Henry, and the garrison surrendered its weapons. The English army moved within its shattered walls and began to rebuild them. The capture of a stronghold to safeguard their beachheads had cost the English 2,000 men. Ominously too, the weather was turning, the sun giving way to torrential rain, which turned the parched land into a quagmire. Further news came in to dampen English spirits. The French had raised three massive contingents that were now converging to form an army. King Henry was left in a quandary, with a number of options, none of which matched his original plan of a quick siege and rapid chevauchée to Bordeaux. He could remain in Harfleur or return to England, but this would have been seen as a defeat. The Dauphin, with the advantage of large numbers of fit, fresh troops over King Henry, was not likely to agree to his request for single combat. As King Edward III had done on the Crecy campaign 69 years earlier, King Henry now decided to take what was left of his army on a forced march north to Calais. Accordingly, on October the 6th, 1415, King Henry left Harfleur with 1,000 men-at-arms, 5,000 archers, and a few carts. Before them, their march of 150 miles through hostile territory, with three French armies waiting to pounce on them. The first part of the march was to follow the coast north to the River Somme. In pouring rain, the army set off, marching in three battles. Despite the continuing rain and the sudden attacks of sickness, which weakened many men, the tiny army continued on its way, marching between 15 and 20 miles a day. King Henry had sent word to Sir William Bardolph, captain of Calais, to immediately dispatch a force of 300 mounted men-at-arms to secure the ford at Blanchetac, to allow the king's army to cross the Somme River. If the English could get over the Somme, they stood a fair chance of completing the 60 miles or so to Calais and safety. The news from King Henry's scouts was, however, the worst imaginable. The ford had not been secured by Sir William, but by Jean Bouchicourt, Marshal of France, who, with a force equal to King Henry's, had staked the crossing and awaited the English on the far side. King Henry knew that an attempt to take the ford by storm would be disastrous. Henry had no choice. He He would have to lead his army along the south bank of the Somme in the hope of finding an unguarded crossing. The English army turned from Blanche Tack and began marching inland away from Calais and deeper into the heartland of France. As most of his army was now on foot, they probably did not appreciate the extra burden, although it was to prove a fortunate one. King Henry now had some luck. At Fouy, the Somme suddenly swings in a sweeping bow to the northeast. The French had destroyed all the possible crossing points, and King Henry, by leaving the river's course and cutting swiftly southeast, was able to beat the French to the fords at Béthencourt and Voyenne. On Saturday, the 19th of October, under his personal supervision, King Henry's troops repaired the fords and crossed to the north side of the Somme. On Sunday, the king allowed his men a day of rest. While the English slept and dried their clothes, less than 7 miles away was a large French army. The French sent forward their heralds, and the laws of chivalry were once more carefully observed. In formal terms, the heralds offered battle to the English and asked King Henry what his intentions were. The king replied, "We march straight to Calais, and if our enemies disturb us on the march, it will be at their peril. We do not seek a battle, but neither shall we be moved by fear to march more quickly than we wish to do. Do not interrupt our journey, for the consequence will be a great shedding of Christian blood." The French heralds were then each given a purse of gold crowns, and they returned to their army. By now, it was obvious battle was inevitable. King Henry's soldiers made ready, armor was donned, bowstrings tested, the defensive formation of men-at-arms flanked by archers was assumed. But the expected French onslaught did not happen. And after a while, the English army moved on. As they passed over land that would be remembered 500 years later as the Somme, the English could see disturbing signs of what faced them somewhere ahead. The roads were pitted by the passing of thousands of horsemen. Many of the English soldiers must have known from this what lay before them.
The Battle of Agincourt indicates that the French army and its nobility behind it had learnt nothing from the experiences of earlier parts of the Hundred Years' War. Here they were, a much larger army than those under Henry V on the English side. Masses of cavalry, though, again being used, a mounted knight concept they'd gone back to in large numbers. The same scorn for their own ordinary foot soldiers, whom they tended to trample into the mud when they wanted to go through them.
The French had mustered some 30,000 men, and hundreds more were hurrying to be in the forthcoming battle. There were, however, some worrying echoes of the past, which the French chose to ignore. The French High Command was once more divided in its aims. Marshal Bouchicourt and Constable d'Albret advised caution. With their superior numbers and position, the French could starve the English out and force them to surrender. This was completely unacceptable to the impetuous Dukes of Orléans, Bourbon, and Berry, who wanted an immediate attack. In the end, it was their aggressive counsel that was accepted. While the French nobility diced and talked into the night, ragged English soldiers tried to catch some sleep under the hedges around Maison Saint. The English knights found lodgings in the village houses. While the English lines were silent, there was constant noise from the French army, less than a mile away. At some point during the night, King Henry sent a deputation to the French to negotiate terms to allow his army to withdraw. Sensing victory, the jubilant French refused any compromise, and the English deputation withdrew. There could now be no doubt that there would be a battle in the morning. As the sun rose on the 25th of October, 1415, the English and French finalized their battle plans and armed. The French were being marshaled into three massive battles. The first battle was dismounted and contained some 8,000 French lords. This battle was flanked by crossbowmen and heavy cavalry. The crossbowmen would begin the battle by bombarding the English archers and allowing the heavy cavalry to charge and disperse them. The French vanguard would then advance, engage, and defeat the English men-at-arms. The 14,000-strong second French battle was in support. The even larger French rear division was mounted and would remain in reserve until the English were routed. Then it would sweep down on the survivors and deployed into their usual formation. Three battles of men-at-arms, side by side, interspersed with wedges of archers. The whole line curved slightly so that the flanking wedges were slightly in advance of the center. In front of the army, the stakes had been driven into the ground. King Henry was in command of the center, the Duke of York, the right wing, and Thomas, Lord Camoys, the left. The two forces were flanked on either side by woods, and now were separated by about 3/4 of a mile. King Henry addressed his army, reminding them of the justice of his quarrel, exhorting them to remember their families and country, and telling them of the French promise to cut off the archers' fingers if they won. In order to stand any chance at all, King Henry had to goad the French formations into attacking his line. Accordingly, the king gave the order, "In the name of God Almighty, in the name of Jesus and Mary, in the name of the Trinity, advance, banner, and St. George this day been thine help." Pausing only to kneel and cross themselves and kiss the ground, the English army advanced towards the French. At a distance of some 200 yards from the French lines, the English halted, and the archers drove their stakes into the muddy ground once more. The French had expected to attack on their terms and were enraged when the archers then drew back their bows and loosed the first destructive flight into their packed ranks. At the same time, the French vanguard lowered its weapons and began to advance. The flanking cavalry dug in its spurs and charged at the archers. As the first English arrows struck the French, things were already going wrong for them. The formations of cavalry on the French flanks had forced the crossbowmen into the woods or behind them, where they could take no active part in the battle. The muddy ground made it difficult for the French to advance. The enthusiasm of the French nobility to fight in the vanguard meant that its overwide front was entangled with its own cavalry. Into this advancing mass, the archers, some able to fire 10 arrows a minute, were pouring volley after volley. French cavalry on the flanks had to attack head-on because of the woods. Unable to get through the stakes, with horses maddened by arrow wounds and men falling and drowning in the mud, the flank attacks were routed. Flanking cavalry fell back in disarray. They collided with the already confused vanguard. Men struggling to advance on foot through sucking mud and vicious arrow storms were knocked flying by riderless horses panicking through them. As the arrows did their deadly work, the line broke up into columns as the French closed up and increased their speed. As they hit the English line, there was a fearful crash. Driven back, the English men-at-arms began to fight for their lives. The French vanguard was now being fired upon from the flanks. As it closed on its center, men no longer had room to wield their weapons. The treacherous ground meant numbers of knights lost their footing and were trampled into the mud by those behind them. And still, the lethal arrows hissed through the air. The English were able to recover and counterattack. Large numbers of French dead and wounded lay in muddy, bloody piles in front of the English.
Epic.
The second French division, the main guard of 14,000 men, marched forward into the arrows. Again, their densely packed ranks were an easy target. Those on the flanks and rear began to fall back, despite the orders of their commanders. The French rear guard, too, began to melt away as the result of the battle became clear. And many of the French nobility, shocked and appalled at the carnage, chose to ride or march forward to their deaths rather than desert so many of their peers. As the fighting slackened, the English moved amongst the struggling mass, looking for men of wealth to take prisoner. If victorious, the English could make a fortune by ransoming these men to their relatives. But victory was still not assured. Despite losses, the French still had unbroken forces in the field, outnumbering the exhausted but ecstatic English army. Just as victory seemed certain, King Henry received word that his baggage train was under attack from a French force that had arrived too late to take part in the main battle. The king was also aware of the fact that he had a substantial number of captured Frenchmen to his rear. These men were still capable of carrying arms if rescued. The king then made a terrible decision. He ordered the extinction of all but the most valuable French prisoners. The English, however, at first refused the king's orders, not wishing to lose valuable ransoms. Before it was realized that the English were safe, a substantial number of French prisoners were dead. The battle had lasted a little over 3 hours. In that time, 10,000 Frenchmen had died, and 1,500 had been taken prisoner. English casualties were less than 300.
Now, besides the English discipline and the formations of their longbow and the effective use of them, there was other reasons for English success. For example, the war was always fought on French soil. That being the case, English soldiers were eager to fight because they could look forward to rich plunder, while their own homeland suffered none of the disasters of war. Worst of all for the French was the fact that they often were badly divided. The French crown had always had to fear provincial attempts to assert autonomy, especially during the long period of warfare. Then there were several highly inept kings, and the English encouraged internal French dissensions. Many aristocratic provincial leaders took advantage of the confusion to ally with the enemy to seek their own advantage. The most dramatic and fateful instance was the breaking away of Burgundy, whose dukes from 1419 to 1435 allied with the English, an act which called the very existence of an independent French crown into question. It was in this dark period that the heroic figure of Joan the Arc came forth to rally the French. In 1429, Joan, an illiterate but extremely devout peasant girl, sought out the uncrowned French ruler, Charles VII, to announce that she had been divinely commissioned to drive the English out of France. Charles was persuaded to let her take command of his troops, and her piety and sincerity made such a favorable impression on the soldiers that their morale was raised immensely. Arriving at Orleans, Joan immediately set about to set up better defenses. She appealed to the English commanders to raise the siege, but received only abuse and threats that if she were caught, she would be burned as a witch. Undeterred, she led assaults against the English positions and was wounded by an arrow, but refused to be confined to bed and was with the French soldiers as they overran the English containments and raised the siege. The raising of the Siege of Orleans was the decisive moment in the Hundred Years' War. The example of Joan of Arc freed the French people from their obsession with defeat at the hands of the English. Without Joan's inspiration, it seems unlikely that Orleans could have resisted for much longer, and having fallen, it would have heralded the collapse of the French monarchy and the fragmentation of the country at the hands of not only the English, but of the great noblemen like the Duke of Burgundy. The heroic peasant girl of Lorraine created the French people. Until her time, France had been inhabited by Avignons, Bourbonians, Burgundians, Poitevins, Armagnacs, Bretonians. But now, the baptism of fire through which the land had passed and the breath of heroism that emanated from the Maid of Orleans had welded together the conflicting sections and had informed them with the breath of patriotism that the beginning of a national life was at hand. France had at length become United Nations. Months, the French had brought Charles to Reims, where he was crowned king. But in May 1430, Joan was captured by the Burgundians and handed over to the English, who accused her of being a witch and tried her for heresy. Condemned in 1431 after a predetermined trial, she was publicly burned to death in the market square at Rouen. Nonetheless, the French, fired by their initial victories, continued to move on the offensive. When Burgundy withdrew from the English alliance in 1435, and the English king, Henry VI, proved to be totally incompetent, there followed an uninterrupted series of triumphs for the French side. In 1453, the capture of Bordeaux, the last of the English strongholds in the southwest, finally brought the long war to an end. The English now held no land in France, except for the port channel, which they ultimately would lose. Before Joan of Arc in 1429, the French only controlled the green area in France, the English the pink. However, after Joan of Arc, the French took control of all the area and kicked the English out of French territory. The brown area that you see there is the territory of Burgundy, which would soon come in line with France. After the Great Schism finally ended in 1417 by the Council of Constance, the largest ecclesiastical gathering in medieval history, there assembled prelates who made certain to gain the crucial support of secular powers and also to eliminate the prior claimants before naming a new pope. After the council's election of Martin V, in 1417, European ecclesiastical unity was thus fully restored, but a struggle over the nature of church government followed immediately. The members of the Council of Constance challenged the prevailing medieval theory of papal monarchy by calling for a more balanced conciliar government. In two momentous decrees, they stated that a general council of prelates was superior in authority to the Pope, and that such councils should meet regularly to govern the church. Surprisingly, Subsequent popes, who had now returned to Rome, sought to nullify these decrees. When a new council met at Basile in 1431, in accordance with the principles laid down at the Constance, the reigning pope did all he could to sabotage its activities. Ultimately, he was successful. After a protracted struggle, the Council of Basile dissolved in 1449 in abject failure, and the attempt to institute constitutional government in the church was completely defeated. But the papacy only won this victory over conciliarism by gaining the support of the rulers of the European nations. In separate concordance with kings and princes, the popes granted the secular rulers much authority over their own local churches. The popes thus became assured of only theoretical supremacy at the cost of surrendering much of their real power. To compensate for this, they concentrated on consolidating their own direct rule in central Italy. Most of the 15th century popes ruled very much like any other princesses, leading armies, jockeying for alliances, and building magnificent palaces. Hence, although they did succeed for the first time in creating a viable political state, their reputation for disinterested piety remained low.
By the time Constantine XI inherited the imperial throne in 1449, Constantinople was surrounded by an aggressive enemy. Constantinople had become a Christian enclave in the middle of the Ottoman Empire, which now extended from the Danube to the Euphrates, including Bosnia, Bulgaria, Greece, and Serbia. The young Sultan was well educated in the arts, languages, and the sciences. He was a man excited by new ideas. He made sure his troops were equipped with the latest weapons. Mehmet wanted to be remembered as the conqueror, the Sultan who succeeded where all his forefathers had failed. It was the Emperor Constantine who now stood in his way. Constantine was proud of his inheritance. The city was his life, and he would defend it to the last. Constantine paid gold to his enemies in an attempt to keep the peace. Mehmet watched Constantinople run out of money and refused to renegotiate the terms. In the winter of 1451, he cut off Constantinople's supplies. He built his own massive fortress, the Rumeli Hisar. It had walls 25 feet thick and was completed in only 4 months. From there, Mehmet now commanded the Bosphorus, where the strait is at its narrowest. With this new castle, the Sultan was able to put a stranglehold on Constantinople's shipping, severing the city's lifeline. Ships loaded with Ukrainian grain could not pass the Ottoman cannon. When Mehmet ordered his navy into the Sea of Marmara, the blockade was complete. Constantinople was cut off from the rest of the world. Constantine was desperate. He even approached the hated Catholic Church for military assistance. He sent gifts to the Sultan and promised to increase the gold shipments. Mehmet wasn't interested, but he did offer Constantine a deal. Territory in Greece and religious freedom for his population in exchange for the city. Constantine refused. How could he surrender his city and everything that was its heritage? Classical Greece, Rome, and Christianity. On April the 6th, the Sultan pitched his red and gold tent outside the city walls. The defenders of the city awoke to a chilling sight. as they looked out over the Ottoman camp. They were outnumbered by 10-1. At the heart of the Sultan's army was an elite corps of Muslim converts, the Janissaries. These zealously aggressive troops were recruited as children from the Ottoman Empire's most warlike
An army state. Of slaves. They were the sword of Allah and the scourge of Christendom. In the 15th century, Christian Europe stared into the face of unholy terror. Rising out of Asia Minor like a whirlwind, the Ottoman Turks stormed into Eastern Europe. City after city fell, Christians trembled, and the Pope called for a new crusade against the heretics of Islam. The Turks did not fear these holy warriors, for the Sultan had his own, his elite infantrymen, the Janissaries, respected by Muslims, dreaded by Christians, and surpassed by no one. Bukhri Haidar was a Janissary, a slave, the personal property of the Sultan. Islamic law forbade enslaving Muslims, but not infidels. A 14th century sultan spared the lives of Christian soldiers taken as prisoners of war in return for their unswerving loyalty. Legend has it that a holy man dubbed them Yenicheri, the new troop destined to spread terror wherever they went. These were the first Janissaries.
Whenever the Turks invade foreign lands and capture their people, an imperial scribe follows immediately behind them, and whatever boys there are, he takes them all into the Janissaries and gives 5 gold pieces to each one and sends them across the sea.
The Ottoman Empire was soon growing faster than its army. In 1438, the Sultan levied a tax on every Christian family under his rule. The payment? One of their sons. Every 5 years, the Sultan's representatives scoured the countryside to collect the tax. He could not take an only son, nor a gypsy, since gypsies were considered unreliable. But any other healthy boy between 8 and 18, like Bukhri Haidar. From their Balkan villages, 2,000 recruits were marched hundreds of miles to the Sultan's court. At the Ottoman capital, Edirne, Bukhri Haidar was rigorously tested in mind and body. How he fared would decide his service. The most gifted were sent to the Sultan's palace to be trained as his bodyguards. In time, many would lead his government and his army. The majority of slave boys were destined for the rank and file of the Janissary Corps. Bukhri Haidar was first sent to the estate of a Turkish noble to work as a farmhand. There, he learned the Turkish language and faith, surrendering his Christian name for a Muslim one. 3 or 4 years later, he returned to Edirne to learn a trade, masonry, carpentry, or blacksmithing. The future leaders of the Janissary Corps had a stricter education. Supervised by the chief eunuch, the boys were kept at the Sultan's palace under lock and key. In 1444, alarmed at the spread of the Muslim Empire, the Pope declared a holy war. Against the Crusaders, Bukri Haidar would put his long education to the test. At the Black Sea port of Varna, Christianity and Islam met in battle. The Christian leader, the King of Hungary, formed his lines. On his right, mercenaries and French knights. On his left, soldiers led by Vlad II, the father of Count Dracula. Across the field, the Sultan likewise placed himself in the center with his trusted Janissaries.
The Janissaries before him, and behind them the camels, and a trench is made up all around, and a rampart heaped up next to it.
The Christians attacked. They charged the Turkish right so fiercely that the line broke. On their left, the Turks counterattacked just as hard.
The battle went on until the afternoon, and heads rolled on the field like pebbles.
By evening, weakened and facing defeat, the Ottoman army took flight. Only the Janissaries remained.
The Janissaries sought out a place at the foot of the mountains among some gorges and tall heather, so that the enemy could not notice that there was any trench before them. And leaving the first trenches, they pretended to take flight.
As the Hungarian king pressed on, one of his generals tried to stop him.
You don't want to fight the archers in the hills, for they will kill your horses and your men will be lost.
No two Janissaries carried the same weapons, save for the bow. Bukri Haidar had long ago mastered the skill of archery. From far off, his arrows rained down on the Crusaders.
The king marched straight upon them, wanting to crush them swiftly. Thus, this gorge became completely full of cavalry. Then, leaping out, the Janissaries beat them and killed them as they wished.
In the thick of the fight, Bukri Haidar faced a resplendent knight.
This Janissary, having noticed the fine armor and the feather and clasp on his helmet, cut off his head and brought it before the Sultan, and throwing it before him said, "Fortunate Lord, here is the head of some famous enemy of yours."
It was the King of Hungary. The Janissaries had routed the Christians, but the casualties were so terrible that the Sultan vowed, "May Allah never grant me another such victory." Bukri Haidar was rewarded with promotion. Returning to his barracks, however, he lived a monastic life. As a slave, he was forbidden to drink, gamble, or marry. all his time was spent training for war. Better prospects would come only by distinguishing himself before his master, the Sultan.
They have their task in common. At night, to lie near the Sultan and take the night watch silently. Rain or snow, winter or blizzard, each must remain in his place. Each night, 50, and 100 when necessary.
Even slaves had to be kept satisfied if their loyalty was to be kept. Bukhra Haidar received an allowance for weapons, a bonus whenever a new sultan took power, and his regular wages.
Wages are paid by the imperial court every quarter year in full and without fail, and it also gives them clothing once a year.
The sultan's money was well spent. Fear preceded the Janissaries. Victory followed. Their very music, crashing cymbals and pounding drums, was dreaded. Unstoppable, they swept through the Balkans like a scythe. Bukhra Haidar served under a corporal in a squad of 10, with its own pack horse, tent, and treasury.
They are diligent and get up early in the morning. They are frugal when on the road and live on only a little food, a little badly baked bread and some raw meat.
Their camps were well kept, their latrines well ordered, their ranks well disciplined. Cowardice, disobedience, and desertion were punished by death. Yet so devoted were the Janissaries to Allah and each other that it was said 10,000 of them could be led by a thread. Nine years after the Battle of Varna, the Janissaries came to the last bastion of Christendom in the East, Constantinople. Like his forefathers, the new Sultan, Mehmet II, had long eyed this prize. 30 years before, his father had tried to take the city and failed. Mehmet would prepare better.
And Albania to wage this holy war against Constantinople. Mehmet gave Constantine one last chance. He sent a message under a flag of truce to the city.
I will, as the law commands, spare you, the citizens of this great city, harm neither your families nor your belongings, if you voluntarily surrender to me.
Constantine rejected the ultimatum. Mehmet attacked. Against the odds, Mehmet's troops were turned back. The first victory went to Constantine. Stunned by this defeat, the Sultan was forced to change his tactics. He brought in artillery to destroy the city's massive walls. Most impressive of all was a giant cannon, the largest gun ever made. It was an astonishing 29 feet from muzzle to breech with a 26-inch bore, and fired a half-ton marble cannonball more than a mile. It required 60 oxen and 400 men to use it, and took 2 hours to load. The cannon enabled the Ottomans to fight with the most sophisticated piece of weaponry in the world. More than 60 large cannons were cast in temporary foundries outside Constantinople. An eyewitness wrote,
"The assault continued day and night with no relief from the clashes and explosions.
For the Sultan hoped to take the city easily, since we were few against many, by pounding us to death. He allowed us no rest from the attack.
With continuous salvos, the Ottoman cannon breached the wall in several places, but the Byzantines defiantly fought off the assaults and repaired the walls. Mehmet then built a huge siege tower, only to see it burnt to the ground by a small raiding party from inside the walls. 12 weeks into the siege, neither the artillery barrage nor the attacks by the Muslim army had been successful. The Sultan's army was on the point of deserting, and he was forced to rethink his strategy. Until now, he had only been able to attack small sections of the wall that were easily defended. Most of Constantinople was protected by the sea. On the northern side of the city, the Christians had stretched a great chain across the mouth of the Golden Horn, thus blocking access to the city's harbor. Mehmet, in a moment of genius, bypassed the chain by hauling part of his fleet across a narrow stretch of land. Overnight, they brought 30 ships into Constantinople's protected harbor. As dawn broke, the Christians woke to discover that the Ottoman war fleet had surrounded the city. The Christians were devastated, and morale collapsed. But Emperor Constantine stood by his decision to defend his city to the last. This moment, Mehmet used another brilliant tactic. He aimed all his cannons at the same section of the wall. Within a month, the walls began to crumble. Victory in sight, luck also played its part in securing the Ottoman victory. The lost tomb of Eyüp Ensari, friend and fallen disciple of the Prophet Muhammad, was found by two Janissaries close to the city walls. This was taken as a good omen for an Islamic victory. The Christians received different omens. Their tradition held that the city of Constantinople would never fall while the moon was in the heavens. But on the night of the 24th of May, there was a full eclipse of the moon, bringing 3 hours of darkness. An evil omen indeed. The prayers continued throughout the night, and the church filled with refugees as the sound of Ottoman artillery grew ever more intense. Commander wrote,
"The reports of muskets, the ringing of bells, the clashing of arms, the cries of fighting men, the shrieks of women, and the wailing of children produced such a noise that it seemed as if the earth trembled."
As night gave way to day, word came that the walls had finally been breached. Soon, the first Ottoman soldiers forced their way into the cathedral, bringing to an end 1,000 years of Roman history. The last outpost of the Roman Empire, Byzantium, had fallen. The victorious soldiers spent 3 days of looting, raping, and killing. Men were butchered, women and children became slaves. Mehmet made his entrance into the city. He went straight to the holiest of the Christian shrines, the Church of the Holy Wisdom, St. Sophia. While a Muslim cleric sang, "There is no God but God," the Sultan proclaimed St. Sophia a mosque. The Roman Empire had come to an end. Emperor Constantine was dead. Where his grave is now is lost to history. However, not far from this church, a headless body was found. The corpse wore purple boots on which the imperial double-headed eagles were embroidered. Many believed that this was Constantine the 11th, the last Roman emperor who had died defending his city and his people. Perhaps his grave is here. The day after the conquest, Mehmet issued a decree stating the heart of the Ottoman Empire, which proved to be one of the world's most powerful and long-lasting. It survived for over 500 years until the end of the First World War. The conquest of Constantinople by the Ottomans was a turning point that sent shockwaves throughout the world. The very survival of Christianity in Europe was threatened. The Silk Road was closed. The great trade route to the east was no longer in Christian hands. Europe turned westwards in search of a new route. The age of discovery had begun.